Okay, hello. I'm going to record myself doing a little painting today, a little painting and drawing. I'm doing a commission for my friend Ventarix, who I play Guild Wars with. And I'm just going to be working on the line art for her commission and doing a little drawing. This is of her character Autumn. Autumn Sunshine, who is a Silvari character in the game Guild Wars 2. And I don't know her that well because I tend to play with Trin's other character, Riaf. But I know that Autumn is an elementalist and a dancer, and she does some pretty cool stuff with fire, and she has some fire wings that I think she can summon, which is awesome. And I'm excited to be drawing Autumn because she is a very unique designed character. She's Silvari, but she looks sort of reptilian, and I think that's great. I love it when people use Silvari in new ways and come up with new things because they're such a versatile race, and I love seeing people who create a character very much based on a plant or a tree, like I did with most of mine. I always pick a plant for them to be associated with, but know that other people have tried other things which have turned out really well. Like, somebody I know has made Silvari that's an anemone, like a undersea anemone, and he's pretty fascinating. I think since we were given such a open-ended kind of lore with Silvari, I mean, obviously there's stuff that we know from the game description and from the blog posts and stuff, but there's some questions that haven't been answered, and that allows us to go a little wilder with our fan theories and our role-playing ideas, and I think that's great. I know there are a lot of people who are sort of purists when it comes to that kind of thing. They like to make sure that the world that they're role-playing in is completely by the book and only based on what the developers have said outright. And that's fine. I think one of the great things about role-playing as a hobby is that it's a little bit like fan fiction in that you get to create stories within a world, and sometimes they're exactly what the people who initially created that world envision, and sometimes they're a little different. And as long as you find like-minded people who just want to create and have fun, and they like sharing maybe nonsensical ideas with you, then You can create anything you want. Just made a little mistake here. I was promising myself that I didn't want to get too precious with the hands here, because then they would look a little different from the rest of the body, because I'm doing most of the line work from a distance and not getting too like obsessed with detail, which I think gives it a more a warmer look to the image, and that's really what I wanted to do with this. But if I zoom in too close, then my lines get too perfect. That makes it look a little machine-like, I guess. I don't know how to describe it. This hand also, I just started making it up as I go along. I'm not 100% confident in the exact pose, but it's kind of like what I like doing with hands. I wasn't always confident with drawing them, but now I feel a little more confident enough so that I can. Yeah, that would, that doesn't work. That I can experiment and see what might happen if I thought about, the hand in a certain way and bending the fingers for a more whimsical pose. Right now I have been thinking about the arrangement of the knuckles here. And her thumb is here and some of her front knuckles there. If this hand is getting a little bit away from me, but if turns out looking okay, then I won't feel bad. I won't be too obsessed with the anatomy that it has to be perfect. I think I'm gonna leave it like that. So, this is my first time recording me speaking over my painting or drawing or anything like that. I just felt like I sort of wanted to talk, but I'm not really comfortable talking to myself. Because weirdly enough, I'm like shy about being even in my own company. Which is a little weird for somebody who's as introverted as I am, I guess. Even though I know no one will hear me when I'm talking, I know that I will hear me. And I'm one of my worst critics. In fact, I think I am the worst critic I have ever had on myself. And so I think if I allow myself to speak when it's only me who's listening, I can be very mean to myself, and I don't like that. So I'm speaking to you instead while I draw. A lot of the time when I was learning to draw, my teacher would say that I'm focusing too much on the head. And the face, because that's the fun part, that's the juicy part. That really makes it come together once you've got it down right. And I heard that so often from my teachers that I eventually started just forgetting to draw the head entirely. I just would stop paying attention to it and focus on the way the body looks before I even think about the head. And that created some new unique problems, one of which was that I was making the heads way too small. I used to make them really big and I would get in trouble for that. So not only was I not focusing on the head anymore, I wasn't even making it the right size. I was overcompensating. And that led me to sort of have some weird proportional issues with the head, and also, like I said, about not wanting to get too precious. I don't want the head to look like it was like cut and paste out of a different drawing because of the level of detail or of intensity. So I've been trying recently to be a little more cavalier about working on the head and the face and not letting it, whoop, that eye is weird, not letting it dominate the much and spend too much time focusing on it. I'm still terrible about that, but I'm trying a little harder. And they say that mindfulness is the key to change, right? Someone says that. I don't know. I wonder if I'm making her look a little too mammalian, I guess. She's supposed to be quite lizard-like, I think. And I, all of this is sort of based on conjecture of what I've seen of this character through my friend Antarix's own art. And her descriptions of the character, since I haven't actually role-played with Autumn. But she always looks pretty reptilian, so I wonder if I should be giving her lips at all, but Antarix did approve the sketch with lips, so I'm just gonna go ahead and do that. I like drawing characters with nice pillowy lips because I personally have very little in the lip department, and I have always thought that people with bigger lips are more attractive, so I guess that's me having a little insecurity showing in my art. Okay, now let's do the dreaded lip test. Oh, it's not that bad. Okay, just gotta she looks a little drunk. Gotta raise this eye up a little. That. I think. Change this up a little bit. And then her eyes are not really looking in the same place. I have to fix the pupils. I didn't learn about this flipping trick for long time until after I started drawing digitally, and it has made me such a better artist, especially when it comes to faces. I don't know if any of you other artists out there have looked at your own art years later and realized, like, I thought that chin looked perfect when I drew it, but it is way to the right, or it's too thin, or, you know, so many problems that you didn't even see when you were first working on it, because, I don't know, when you're a young artist, you just have this sort of, like, blindness sometimes to anatomy problems, I think. Which is fine. I mean, like, how else are you supposed to learn except by trying? And I know that I still have so many issues that I work on constantly. That looks a little better. That's a nice happy face. Okay. Sound like Bob Ross. See, now I think they're a little tilted. I'm not sure. center. Maybe if I go like this, select it, tilt it a little bit. That's better. On the subject of Bob Ross, I really, really like him. I think he was a great person and a good man. And I know like maybe somebody's gonna come up and say like, "Oh, your fave is problematic." But he was an inspiring artist for so many people, and he taught people to be kind to themselves when they work, and to remember that painting should make you happy and that you can do whatever you want. Nobody is allowed to tell you, "No, you can't do that," because it's your painting, it's your imagination, it's your world, as he says. So screw everybody who wants to get in your way. When I was in art school, or at school, I didn't go to an art school, but I studied painting at my school. I was told that my work looked like Bob Ross, and I was really hurt at the time because they meant it as an insult. They meant that it looked, I don't know, I guess cookie cutter, mass produced, or you know, like I wasn't looking hard enough or something. It really hurt my feelings, but now that I know Bob Ross more and I have seen his work and his show, I watch his show a lot when I'm trying to focus on creating myself. I feel so much better about having been compared to him because I don't think my teachers knew it at the time, but they were giving me a compliment. Because he may not have been the world's finest artist, but he was a good influence and a good thinker and just a generally good person. And we have so few of those. And it's hard, it's so hard as a young artist who thinks that they're alone in what they love, or that nobody understands them, to have an influence like that who can just reassure them, "You're doing fine and you are doing exactly what you're supposed to do, and every drawing you make may not be a masterpiece, but it's a little piece of your history that will go on to be a part of your great oeuvre." It's shaping you as the artist that you are meant to be, which is really important to remember and to cherish. Because if you are at all compelled to create art, you have a gift that some people don't, which is passion, just in general. Passion in itself is an immense gift. The fact that you can feel excited or inspired by anything is wondrous, and you should feel proud of yourself that you can do that. Because some people go through their entire lives without passion, and that is really sad. So if you have passion, be proud of yourself for it. Even if it's passion for something that other people think is stupid. For instance, creating part of video game characters. something that I love to do and that I'm constantly unable to describe to other people what I do or why I love it. But it makes me so happy and I love to share it with other people who also, you know, love games, love creating, love thinking. And that's why the internet is a great place, boys and girls. Because it can connect you with someone across the country or across the entire world who cares about the same stuff that you do. And you can form a lifelong friendship just based on, I care about this thing, I'm really passionate about it, you do too? That's amazing. Let's be best friends. And that's something brave and bold and new for our generation and for our world. So, hooray! Let's embrace it. Let's be kind to each other. And to be kind to ourselves, which is the hardest part, in my opinion. I've been ranting about artistic life for, I don't know, what, 10 minutes? Maybe more than that. I'm sorry. It's just something that gets my motor running, I guess, when I'm talking. Working on autumn for hair, and I used to have a Silvari who had a long ponytail like this, named Saffron. Shout out to anybody who remembers or recognizes her. And she had this hairstyle, and I suffered trying to draw it because leaves in general are very difficult to draw for me. I have trouble thinking about them in dimension, in perspective. Like, even now, look, I'm trying to sort of figure out how these leaves lie on top of each other. It's not exactly the easiest thing in the world for me. And I think this hairstyle is one of the ones where you can't hide very well. You have to be able to show that you can turn these leaves in space and show them cascading down. Like, I want to say that they're like banana leaves, but I haven't actually seen a banana tree in real life or even seen a picture of one. I should Google a picture of one, but I think that banana leaves are long and soft, sort of like this. Maybe? Don't be mean to me, internet, if I got that wrong. But, I think that's kind of what banana leaves are like. Anyway, it's a hard hairstyle to draw. And if you have mastered the leafy ponytail, then, I applaud you. I was about to say with the depths of my heart, but you can't really applaud with your heart. I reached out to you, I guess, from the depths of my heart. Okay, time to start a little more of the detail on Autumn's jewelry. She's very fancy in this outfit, and it's quite pretty. I think my friend Ventarx up with this outfit herself, which is quite cool. Guild Wars 2 has many, many style options. Not as many as we would like, I know, but has enough so that we can get by, but I love it when people design their own outfits for their characters, because I know that it's not easy to get the exact look that you want. did, you missed the time to get it. It was a seasonal item or only in the gem store for so long, and so you missed it. I have that problem. I'm waiting for the Aetherblade set to come around again so that I can buy it, assuming I have the money for it. From my one character who has more of a steampunk vibe to him. But anyway, Dream came up with a very cool idea for this, and I'm just gonna really say that these are. My reference isn't quite clear about what kind of material these are. I think they're either gold cloth or chains. I'm gonna assume that they're some kind of cloth, like little ribbons, maybe. Because they seem pretty thick, and my reference, and I wanna honor the reference as much as I can. I always wonder about that when somebody gives you a reference and says, please draw this, and you think, okay. But I can't quite tell what you meant by this or this. And you can always ask, and you should always ask if you're an artist doing a commission, because it's better to do it beforehand than have to go back in and fix it, especially if you're doing something very complicated that would require quite a lot of fixing. So, Pentax is a friend of mine, so she says, no, those are actually chains. Can you please fix them? I would be fine doing that, and I wouldn't charge her for it, because it would be a mistake on my part for not asking, but it's important as a commissioner to also say, hey, I'm working off what you gave me, a description of reference, whatever, and if I get something wrong, I'm sorry, but if it's going to take me more than an hour to fix it, I'm going to have to charge you a little more. Because you don't have to, punish yourself for making a mistake when maybe something wasn't as clear as it should have been. And just edits in general, if they're going to take you a long time, you should charge for that, because you made your initial piece of artwork, and if they don't like it, they're not entitled to you fixing it over and over again until they get what they want. Because that is a waste of your time, and you're trying to make money off of this. So be careful, be kind, but be careful. I always think it's best to be kind to people, because even though there's some real dicks out there, sorry to use some colorful language, but in general, people are good and they respond to kindness. If you can get out of the gate first and be nice to them, then they'll probably try hard to be nice to you in return, because people like to be liked. More of my philosophizing here, I'm sorry. I shouldn't be. I shouldn't be preaching to you guys. I'm just trying to think of things to talk about while I work. Doing a little bit of dangly, sparkly stuff, which I love. I'm glad that Autumn has some of these things on her, because they're fun. And when I go in and cut this, I can make each one of them shiny. Autumn is a bright red color. She's very, like she looks like an autumn sunset, even though her name is Autumn Sunshine. So she has a lot of dark colors on her and like a dark sort of crimson red and some vibrant yellows and things like that. So I have to think about how I want the color to complement or contrast with her base colors. Oh, look at that. So many little line art issues. Here's me. I'm drawing hands. I tend to just lock in the knuckles always, even I should have the finished drawing at that point. I tend to be a little sketchy with my line art, even just because I did a lot of traditional art before I started working at all with digital media. I mean, I have my degree in oil painting, which technically I made into a degree in screw you and doing whatever I want. And I ended up doing my final presentation with digital art, but let's just ignore that for the time being. I grew up and through my formative teenage years was using just a pencil on paper to draw, and I got really good, well, in my opinion, I got pretty good at doing like graphite lines, and so doing line work in pen was always like uncomfortable for me because it makes such a stark image. When you are, that's the reason that people are always like, oh my god, like my line art ruined my drawing. It was so good before I did pen. Like, I don't understand why this happened. It's actually because if your brain views something that's sketchier, like it has more lines making it up, it sort of fills in the cracks for you and it sees a more complete image than is actually there. But when there's just one line, as in a confident thick pen line, it goes, ah, that is the image, I see it, it's exactly the way it is. And so if you make some mistakes or cut some corners or like whatever, just the translation from sketch to final image will make changes no matter how carefully you do it. And you've got to think about that, I guess, when you're working on a final image. I think I'm ready to be done with this line art. And then I can move on to painting it. I'll probably find little mistakes later when I go into painting it. Oh no, I found one thing I didn't do. She has more of this ribbon jewelry around her legs. So I'll just quickly do that and then wrap up my rant to you. Along with drawing. I hope it was enjoyable to listen to. This is my first attempt to do sort of a soothing voice video. And I hope it came out well, but if it didn't, That's fine. I hope you enjoyed learning a little bit about my process. And maybe it will have an influence on you, maybe it won't. Either way, I'm grateful for you watching and taking some time to look at how I do things and think about things. I always love watching other artists work whenever I can. Sorry, that was my computer just creaking for no reason. Right, so watch some other artists. Do some sketching on your own. Think creatively. Treat yourself well. Be kind to yourself. And maybe I'll see you again sometime.